What's your name?
Aaron.
I loved you in A Christmas Story, by the way.
Listen, the Pentagon is scared. After New York, aliens, come on. They need to look strong. Stopping the Mandarin is priority, but it's not...
It's not superhero business.
No, it's not, quite frankly. It's American business.
So I said I got it.
Okay.
Broke the crayon.
Are you okay, hey, Mr. Tuck?
Take it easy. Tell me.
How did you get out of the wormhole?
Wait a minute. Tony.
What did you say?
Tony.
Sorry. Just check out the suit. Check the heart, check the, is it the brain?
No sign of cardiac anomaly or unusual brain activity.
Okay, so it's poison?
My diagnosis is that you've experienced a severe anxiety attack.
Me?
Come on, man, this isn't a good look, open up.
Sorry, I gotta split.
Hello, and welcome to the research sofa. I'm gonna talk today about trauma, connection, and the COVID-19 pandemic. So, first of all, who am I? I'm Lauren Walker, and I'm a trial support officer in the Mental Health and Addiction Research Group. I've been working on a research intervention, Self-Help Plus, with refugees and asylum seekers who've experienced trauma. I've been working on the study for the past year and during the COVID-19 pandemic. I've previously worked on research in severe mental illness, and I'm a current co-applicant on a grant looking at ward safety in psychiatric inpatient units. I have personal experience of trauma and recovery. So, what feels important to talk about? Trauma. So, there's a growing body of research evidence showing the link between trauma, including adverse childhood experiences, attachment trauma, abuse and neglect, intergenerational trauma, shock trauma, natural disasters, and war trauma, and there are others, and the diagnosis of mental illness, and that includes severe mental illness. There's also research that suggests trauma and the automatic fight, flight, freeze, fawn and fragment response in connection with both chronic physical illness and mental ill health, and that's mediated by consistently high levels of cortisol in the body. This framework allows us to understand mental and physical ill health resulting from traumatic experiences as a normal response to overwhelming circumstances. So, COVID-19 as a traumatic experience. The pandemic and the physical distancing and isolation experience is a world event which many may experience as traumatic, and which may lead to fight, flight, freeze responses, to survival reactions, and to overwhelm. There's a current understanding that unresolved past trauma, that trauma can build on one another, and that results in a complex trauma experience. I'm going to talk now about isolation and connection. So one of the hallmark experiences of trauma and a question asked in the diagnosis of PTSD is the internal feeling of being isolated and cut off from others. The PCL5 questionnaire, which is a questionnaire about post-traumatic stress, asks respondents to rate their feelings of feeling distant and cut off from other people. Feelings of shame in trauma, along with feeling emotions and having internal experiences which an individual experiences and feels as not understood by others, can further compound the isolation. So what? So research on the experience of isolation and connection in the severe mental illness population during the COVID-19 distancing could create important openings for future research. And I'm going to talk about this on a social level, on a psychological level, and on a biological level. So the social level first, the research area of physical connection, closeness and nervous system regulation, which is co-regulation in attachment theory terms, might be applied to severe mental illness. On a psychological level, a meta-analysis and further studies on the experience of trauma in those with severe mental illness could be done. And on a biological level, so the fight, flight, freeze, fragment, fawn response and its chemical intermediaries, for example, cortisol, adrenaline, the body's natural opiates and oxytocin might be studied, as well as what is the role of the neurotransmitters currently associated with mental illness. So, hopes and work for the future. I hope that data gathered in this time might lead to a potential parity of research funding for psychological and social factors in the onset and in the long-term experience and in the treatment options for severe mental illness. Thank you very much for watching this episode of the Research Sofa. Take good care and go gently. Thank you.